And welcome to the history of Rotary Scout Reservation. I'm your host, Ed Keelan, and I'll be taking you through a history of camp. In this episode, we'll be looking at the 1970s. I crossed over from Weeblos to Scouts in 1974, so now I can add some of my own recollections, at least from the point of view of a scout. The 1970s saw a decline in the scouting movement. Personally, I think the berets played a big role in this, although it was the 1970s. It could have been way worse. National's response was to make a variety of attempts to change the program. In the early 70s, the outdoor program was de-emphasized. As I mentioned at the end of the last episode, camping wasn't even required for Eagle. A program was also developed for younger scouts that included earning skill award belt loops. From the camp point of view, numbers were down as well. For some years, only 3 weeks of summer camp were operated, and for others, only half the dining hall was used. Despite this, there was a major capital improvement campaign undertaken in the early 70s, and several changes were made to the program. As we've done in earlier episodes, let's begin with the non-program changes. One of the first changes that came from the capital development campaign was the construction of a camp office or administration building. This occurred in 1971. Prior to this, there really wasn't a camp office. Algonquin Lodge served as the office at some point, and what we called the Brown Building was one of the old cabins down by the lake, and that was the office as well. Yeah, we really called it the Brown Building, despite the fact that virtually every building in camp was staying Saratoga Brown. It probably worked because the building next to it was red. What can I say? The Capital Campaign also brought about a new shower house built on the pad of the original one. This is the site of the current shower house as well. In addition to the main one, a second shower and flush toilet latrine was built on the south end of camp to be used by the Family Camping Cub program. There were barbecue grills installed south of the Ranger's residence, and an area was cleared for trailer camping. This photo of one of the old barbecue grills is symbolic of this and most of the other initiatives of the 70s. Despite the de-emphasis on outdoor program, three winter use cabins were built. Two are located on the south end of camp, near the family camping area. These are Seek and Dearborn. They were named after two active volunteers, Ray Seek and Lonnie Dearborn. The third building, also named after active volunteers, is Prue Heyman Lodge, named after Sergeant Prue and Bert Heyman. These log cabin kits were built largely to replace Algonquin Lodge, which we discussed in part 4, and the original Sherman Lodge, which was located just south of the current parade field near Shindaku campsite. This building should not be confused with the old dining hall down by the lake, which was also called Sherman Lodge after the original one was taken down. In addition to these cabins, the Adirondack lean-tos were built just north of Prue Heyman. From a program perspective, there were a number of changes. First of all, merit badges became a major component, as did skill awards for the younger scouts. There was scoutcraft, nature, shooting sports, and aquatic program areas, although we do see some changes in those. Once again, new docks were purchased in what John Tutin referred to as the Boathouse Rebellion. Fortunately, unlike the Boston tax protests 200 years earlier, property damage and tarring and feathering were kept to a minimum. Apparently, putting the 1957 docks in was a hazardous job because it involved diving down and bolting the docks to the underwater anchors. With everything shifting and rusting over the years, the staff refused to do it, and finally new docks were purchased. They were installed by lamplight at night, right before the camp opened. These are the floating docks we still use today. The old swimming dock became the boat dock and was attached to the ice house. You would literally walk right out of the lakeside of the ice house, right onto the boat dock. In addition to swimming and boating, log rolling and trampoline were added to the program. Changes were also made to the rifle range. The firing line was changed, so scouts were shooting to the west, and a much more significant structure was built. Toot went from being the nature director in the 60s to being the rifle range director beginning in the 70s. He would often take all of his vacation from Factory Mutual, where he was a fire protection engineer, and then take unpaid leave for the remainder of the summer, all for no pay. Gotta love the staff tent downrange. The archery range remained in the Hocker Field, but here are some better pictures from the 70s showing more of the range and the archery shack where the equipment was stored. Other changes included the phasing out of the field sports program and the addition of handicrafts. The Catholic Chapel was closed in and it became the Trading Post, Quartermaster, and Handicrafts Building. The handicrafts program consisted of basketry, leatherwork, and wood carving. So in effect, the program became largely the one we see in most scout camps today. Before we end, let me point out that the Governor Clinton Council closed Stratton Mountain Scout Reservation after the summer season of 1979. Because of this, more money became available for Rotary. This, coupled with a camp-oriented council program director and a highly motivated and talented camp ranger, would lead to a decade of great change for Rotary. That's what we'll be talking about in the next episode, the 1980s. Until then.